In this video, we're going to discuss a second form of learning known as classical conditioning. And I'm going to start by detailing a little bit of the history, just briefly, about how we stumbled upon classical conditioning. Because it's kind of like the story of the aplesia when it came to uncovering habituation. We didn't intend to discover anything about learning, but in reality, we did, in a totally unexpected way. So what you see here is Pavlov's dogs. You may have heard of Ivan Pavlov in the past. He wasn't a psychologist at all. He was actually a physiologist who wanted to understand dog digestion. Okay. So again, it's amazing that somebody studying dog digestion ended up uncovering one really key critical thing we always teach in psychology that's so important about learning, which is classical conditioning. So let me tell you a little bit about what Ivan was doing and how he stumbled upon classical conditioning. So again, he's studying dog digestion, and there was a couple important things about his setup. I won't get too in-depth here in describing his apparatus, but I want to at least give you an impression of the key components that led to this discovery. So first of all, there was a bell in the room, and the bell would ring periodically to basically signal that it's time to give the dog their food. And what he did, what Ivan was doing, was he had sort of an implant in the dog's mouth that would collect salivation, basically saliva, right? So the dog would salivate in response to seeing the food, and he would sort of measure how much salivation was coming out of that. And so he did this over and over and over. The bell rang, the dog received the food, the dog salivated in response to the food. The bell rang, the dog received the food, the dog salivated. Okay, hopefully you're getting the idea. The bell rang, the dog receives the food, the dog salivates. So he does this over and over and over. And what he eventually realizes is that if you ring the bell after doing this so often, the dog salivates in response to the bell, even in the absence of food. So the bell rings and the dog salivates and there's no food to be found. Now, a salivary response, basically creating saliva, in response to food is perfectly natural. That's a normal response. It's a healthy response. Salivating in response to a bell is not a natural response. And so this observation led to, again, the discovery of classical conditioning. Classical conditioning is a form of associative learning, meaning we're associating two things together. Two things are being paired together, and so they become associated. So classical conditioning is a form of associative learning in which the stimulus or the experience occurs before the behavior and then gets paired or associated with that behavior. To help understand this more, we're going to introduce some terminology. This is a little bit of a jargon-heavy section we're getting into now, but it's so critical, and there's really no way around the jargon. So I'm going to do my best to sort of map on these terms onto the Pavlov example, and I'm going to discuss all of that. But I really encourage you just throughout, take a pause, make sure you're understanding the terminology, maybe look up more examples online, or try and think of your own examples to apply this terminology to ensure that you fully understand it, because it's not intuitive until you get used to it. So first we have the unconditioned stimulus. The unconditioned stimulus basically means the unlearned stimulus. There's nothing, no learning has happened yet. It's unconditioned. Conditioning has not taken place. The unconditioned stimulus is the stimulus that elicits an automatic response. In this case, our unconditioned stimulus is the food, because it elicits an automatic unlearned response of salivating in response to that food. The salivation is called the unconditioned response, which is an automatic or unlearned response to a non-neutral stimulus. And I'll get to the neutral bit in a little bit. So it's an unconditioned response. It's just unlearned. It just happens. Dogs salivate to food. There's no learning required for that to happen. Now, after the conditioning takes place, after the pairing together of the food and the bell, which is the neutral stimulus, over and over and over, then you get conditioning. So now we have our conditioned stimulus, which is a previously neutral stimulus. So the bell, which was in the beginning neutral, no learning yet, just neutral, didn't elicit any sort of response. But now after conditioning, the previously neutral stimulus comes to elicit a response due to the association with the unconditioned stimulus. So because the bell was paired together over and over and over with the food, now when the dog hears the bell, he thinks of food. And so he salivates in response. So salivation is now a conditioned response. Notice it's the same behavior. Salivation previously was our unconditioned response when it was a response to the food. But now salivation is a conditioned response because it's a response to the bell. So a conditioned response is a response to a previously neutral stimulus that is now the conditioned stimulus due to a learned association. I told you there was going to be a lot of jargon, so again, I'm going to try and help you to map this onto the Pavlov situation one last time, and if it doesn't make sense, pause and rewind a little bit, because I promise once you get enough exposure, it will. Okay, so I want to break down the different steps of conditioning. So at the beginning, this is what you're looking at. This is before conditioning. This is the apparatus. These are the key components. There's a bell, there's food, and there's the salivation. Here's what we have before conditioning. The bell is a neutral stimulus. Before any learning has taken place, before any conditioning, you can ring the bell as much as you want. The dog's not going to salivate. It's neutral in the beginning. Then you have your unconditioned stimulus, that's the food, which elicits the unconditioned response, the natural automatic response of salivation in response to that food. Then you have the conditioning, and this is the pairing together over and over and over of the bell and the food. This is where the association happens. And then finally, after conditioning, now everything is going to be called a conditioned stimulus and a conditioned response because conditioning has taken place. So now the previously neutral stimulus, the bell, is no longer neutral. Now it's a conditioned stimulus because there's a learned response to it. There's a conditioned response, which is the salivation, in response to that bell. Okay, before we finish the video, I have to tell you a little bit of related terminology. There's six different terms that are really important for classical conditioning, and I encourage you to make a note of this so that you can find it later, because when we get to operant conditioning in our next video, a lot of this terminology is actually going to apply to operant conditioning as well. So I'm going to start by telling you the three key phases of classical conditioning, of learning the response and forgetting the response, all of that. So the learning is called acquisition. This is gradually learning or acquiring the conditioned response, which is salivation. And this is caused by the repeated pairing of the conditioned stimulus and the unconditioned stimulus, the CS and the UCS. So again, try and translate this into the example in your mind. So repeated pairing of conditioned stimulus and unconditioned stimulus, this is referring to the repeated pairing of the bell and the food over and over again. Next, we have extinction. Extinction is when the conditioned response decreases in magnitude and eventually disappears altogether. And this is caused by presenting the conditioned stimulus alone without the unconditioned stimulus. So imagine that you've trained Pavlov's dogs to salivate to the sound of a bell. Well, if you sort of present the bell over and over and over and over and over without the food, okay? In the beginning, the dogs will salivate. They're conditioned. They have learned that response. But imagine you present the bell 10, 20, 30 times with no food. Eventually, they're going to figure out that no food is coming, and they're not going to salivate in response to that bell anymore. That's extinction. But what's interesting is you eventually get spontaneous recovery, which is when a seemingly extinct conditioned response reappears. So going back to that previous example, you presented the bell 10, 20, 30 times with no food, and eventually the dog gives up, doesn't salivate anymore, doesn't get their hopes up anymore in response to the sound of the bell. So you stop for the day. And imagine you start the next day again, right? So you ring that bell the following morning. Interestingly, the dog will salivate. So a seemingly extinct conditioned response reappears, showing that the learning is still there at some level. And this is what we call sort of wishful thinking, right? You present the bell again, the conditioned stimulus once more, and you get that conditioned response because the dog sort of hopes that this time they'll get food. All right, three more quick terms, and then we round out the video. So we have the renewal effect, which sounds a lot like spontaneous recovery, but it's actually totally different, and it refers to a very specific sort of scenario. So let's say you train Pavlov's dogs in a room, okay, specific room, and then you go to a different building, different room altogether, and you extinguish that conditioned response, right? So you present the bell 10, 20, 30 times with no food, eventually they give up, all that. Interestingly, if you go back to the original room where you trained Pavlov's dogs in the first place, and you ring that bell, they will salivate. So the renewal effect is when you extinguish a conditioned response in a setting different from the one in which the animal acquired that conditioned response. but then you return to the original setting and the response returns. That's the renewal effect. The final two terms are stimulus generalization and stimulus discrimination, and I'll present both at the same time because they're kind of opposites of one another. So stimulus generalization is when basically conditioned stimuli that are similar but not identical to the original conditioned stimuli elicit a conditioned response. Here's an example. In the Pavlov's dogs example, imagine that instead of a bell, right, after conditioning happened, you train them and everything, but instead of a bell, you pressed a piano key, for example, or you banged a gong or a chime or something, right? Something similar-ish to a bell, but different. The dogs will still salivate. They're generalizing to these new stimuli, and you're getting the same conditioned response. Stimulus discrimination is the opposite. It's related, but it's kind of opposite. And that's where we see a less pronounced conditioned response in response to conditioned stimuli that differ from the original conditioned stimulus. So going back to the example I just mentioned, if you press a key on a piano, you'll probably get a pretty good sort of conditioned response. You'll get a good amount of salivation. If you bang a gong, though, well, now we're getting further away from what a bell sounds like. So you might get some salivation, but it will be much less. That's stimulus discrimination.